I'm quite excited about what God's going to do this morning, because I feel like the layer of the roof has already been peeled back a little bit. How about you just grab your seats, make yourself comfy. And I'm just going to pray, because I think God's up to something this morning. Well, Father, I just thank you for your Holy Spirit. Your Holy Spirit's the greatest minister. And we just know and we welcome you in this room. And Holy Spirit, we thank you that your ways are higher than our ways. Your words are higher than our ways. And we pray, Lord, that your words and your ways would be made known today, God, that your voice would be heard. Father, for every heart that's got questions, Father, every life that's needing answers, God, I pray that you would just breathe your strategy, your answers, your wisdoms into them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. So let's get festival ready. Who's been enjoying this series that we've been doing? Let's get festival ready. You probably saw, if it's your first time today, you probably saw we've got lots of flags. We've got an amazing car that Aliza faithfully has been bringing and parking there every week. And for us as a church, we are really moving together. We're mobilizing together towards the conference called Shout in 10 days. And so we've just decided we're going to get on this journey together. We're going to get festival ready. And we've been looking through, they're called the Psalms of Ascent. So they're from Psalm 120 through to 134. And before you wonder what it is I'm saying, that's the way we say it in Northern Ireland. Psalm, not Psalm. Psalm, okay? So forgive my accent, but that's what I mean. It's a book in the Bible. And it's this group of 15 psalms that they sang. Whenever they would gather together, they would mobilize together, and they would go up to Jerusalem to celebrate big festivals like Passover, Pentecost. And they had smaller ones, but there were three. Deuteronomy 16 just talks about three major festivals where everyone was instructed to darn tool, stop what you're doing, break from work, gather the family, pack what's needed, pack your transport, and everybody went up together as a nation to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem was this place, you reckon it was about 2,500 feet above sea level. So wherever you lived, you were never as high as that. So everybody went up. They physically went up, and that's why they call these the Psalms of Ascent. So it's the songs. I call them the road trip songs, the road trip songs. And God was rallying his people because God knows what we need, doesn't he? He was, like Peter said last week, he invented holy days. He invented holidays. Who's thankful for holidays? You know, one day a week is our Sabbath. It's our holy day, our holiday. But then there were these points throughout the year that we can learn from where God said, no, I want you to stop. I want you to take a break. And I want you to come and meet with me in the temple. And it seems like it was a really normal thing. If you look in Luke chapter 2, verse 41 to 43, it says, every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. And when Jesus was 12 years old, they attended the festival as usual. So it was a normal thing. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth, but Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. So this normal thing, and I love the thought that these psalms were the psalms that Jesus himself sang when he went up year after year after year. These are the words, these are the songs that Jesus would have sung. They were in him. He would have been part of the cry going up to the temple as they went to celebrate. So yes, it's our road trip music, It's our theme tunes for the road. And if you look, Psalm 121, is this, you can feel like you're going on the journey with them. Psalm 121, it says, I look up to the mountains, Mount Zion, like Jerusalem is in view, and they can see their destination. It's within their sight. And then you go on a few different psalms, and you can hear the sense of joy. Psalm 126, it says, the Lord has done amazing things for us. What joy. Like they were going up, and they were getting excited about encountering God. And I think it's brilliant. How many of you have got songs that it's like when you hear that song comes on the radio, you remember the moment, you remember what you were doing, you remember what happened in that season. Anyone? Songs, they are significant, aren't they? And these road trip songs, these Psalms of Ascent, I think God knew what he was doing when they were written because it was helping people remember, do you remember last year how far away we were? And look at us now. Look how far God's brought us. And so I thought we'd play a little game this morning. Who's up for a bit of fun? Yeah. Okay, so my game, I need like a jingle or something, John. I should have given you a heads up. But my game show today is called Name That Song. Name That Song. So who's good at songs? Okay, we can talk. It's all right. You don't have to be quiet. You've got permission to make noise. Name that song. And so my DJ up the top, DJ Johnny, gives a wave. I've got a compilation of 5 songs, and he's going to play like 5, maybe 10 seconds of them, and then you're allowed to shout them out. Okay, so hit it, DJ Johnny. Here we go. Got it. Top Loader, Dancing in the Moonlight. Right, I chose that because every time I hear that, I remember when I finished university. That was the anthem for finishing university and passing. All right, next one, Johnny.
I'm doing just fine now, it's over. I've been moving on and living my life.
A bit more recent.
But occasionally I lose composure.
Anyone?
And I can get you out of my
He's Googling it. Oh my goodness. Okay, this one's called Remember. Becky Hill, David Guetta. For me, this is the theme tune to our holidays. Mark's in one Fiat 500 with his head touching the ceiling, 2 children. I'm in the other Fiat 500, head not touching the ceiling, 2 children. And this is the theme tune. We're getting a Fiat 500 bouncing. So anyway, so for me, I'm like, holidays, Portugal. All right, next one. This one's obvious.
Get down tonight, come on, yeah. I get down tonight, Everybody get down tonight.
Tonight. Hey, you all know it, you all know it. This one, Mark will not be happy that I'm sharing this, but this one reminds me of Mark, because Mark is a massive, massive S Club fan, S Club 7 fan. I said it. And it just reminds me when we were dating, we'd go cruising and he'd put on S Club 7 on our cassette tapes. Yeah. Okay, next one. It's a little bit more deeper. There we go. Darlene Check. There we go. Deborah's got it. Shout to the Lord. And this one for me was so significant. This was like one of those defining songs. I gave my life to Jesus when this song came out. And I just had it on repeat because I could not believe that the King of Kings had chosen me. And that for me was one. We've got one more, a bit more of a recent one. You're doing a great job, DJ. Jaira, there we go. More of a recent one. And for me last year, this was my theme tune. Life went a bit pear-shaped, and I was like, nope, we're putting it on. I'm reminding myself of who God is. He is my provider. He's the one who makes a way. And so for you guys, I'm sure there are songs that are just so defining, and it's like they remind you of how good God is. Those first ones remind me of happy memories, but there are songs that we sing, and they should remind you, that's right, that is who God is. He is the way maker. He is the promise keeper. He's the one that never leaves you, never forsakes you. And so I think these Psalms of Ascent, they should be created in some kind of a Spotify playlist, because they take us on this journey. There's like the ups and there's the downs of life, normal life, the ups and downs. But these songs were written to encourage people as they went up to encounter God. That's right. We are going to meet the creator of the universe, And he has brought us so far. And you know, we are not living in the Old Testament, as you probably realize. We are not physically going on a pilgrimage like these guys were. But in life, we are, in a sense, pilgrims, in that we're following Jesus. We're following Jesus, who's taking us into the presence of God, our Father. And he creates theme tunes that help us to go there. So today, I want to talk to you from Psalm 134. It's a really short psalm. It's the last one in the Songs of Ascent. And it's going to come up on the screen. It says, "Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord who minister by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who is maker of heaven and earth." So this is the final song. This is the final step. The final step on the journey. It's 3 verses. It's not clear who wrote it. But I love the way God weaves himself in the Word of God. There's 15 songs in the Psalms of Ascent. 15, if you didn't realize, represents the number of rest. So this is the final song. There's 15 songs. 15 represents rest. And it's this picture, you know, there's this calling, gathering. Come on, praise God, praise God. Come and praise God. And as we do, he's going to release his rest. I love that, love that. Such a beautiful picture. And, you know, God is wanting to bring us higher and higher, like he did with the pilgrims, journeying up to experience him. You know, the pilgrimage started in Psalm 120. We've been going through some of them over the last few weeks. And Psalm 120, so it's this place, it's called the place of Meshach. And it's a place of woe. It's a place of woe to me. And a journey of life. There are ups and there are downs. Like we talked about the hilltops. We sang about the hilltops and the heartaches. Psalm 120 is a place of woe. And if that's the state that you're in today, then I really want to encourage you to come on a fresh journey with God. Because when you're in that place, you need to ascend. And you can go up the steps into this place of fresh worship and fresh revelation of God. But then Psalm 134, the other end, so we're topping and tailing. 120 starts, it's a place of woe. 134, it's the place of Zion, it's where Jerusalem, it's where the temple is. And that is a place of meeting with God. So we've got these two bookends, starting off a place of woe, horrible, horrible place. But if we commit to the journey, if we commit to the steps, we come to a place of meeting with God. And that is a journey. They did it 3 times a year. God knows us. He knows the cycle of life. Sometimes we need help to get back up to that place. Sometimes we can get stuck along the way, and he knows that we need help to get up there. And so I am quite a visual person. God speaks to me in like everyday things. So I don't know if we've got any fit people, any gym members here. I stopped going to the gym before COVID, and now I've discovered working out at home is great. There are so many videos that you can do. You don't even have to leave your house. It's amazing. And I want to show you a piece of equipment that I loathe. Like, loathe is a strong word, but I really do not have a good relationship with this. And it's called the Stairmaster. Has anyone used it? The stepper? Okay, it's going to come up. In my head, this is what I look like, that guy. But the reality is I'm the girl on the right, like bending over, about to vomit, just like, one more minute, I need to do it. But this is a piece of equipment. If I'm in the gym, I will happily walk past it to get to the rowing machine. I will happily walk past it to get to the treadmill. I don't enjoy it. However, it has a lot of claims of benefit for your health. Apparently, using this, the stepper, you can take it down. That guy is living his best life in the gym. You can. Apparently, it increases your core muscle strength. Who knew? It gives you stronger quads, gives you stronger hams, stronger glutes, stronger calves, and it's good for burning calories, improves your aerobic respiration. It's got a lot of things that is good for you, but it is a challenge. Man, it is a challenge, and I will happily ignore it when I go past. But thinking about the Psalms of Ascent, I was like, man, that's what it is like, in a sense. It's the stepper machine. It's a challenge. Sometimes you're like, oh, I really don't want to do it, but what is on the other side of it? God strengthens you. God conditions you. He shapes you. He causes you to walk with poise if you will commit to taking the stairs. And so, you know, God's called us to go higher. His ways are higher. His thoughts are higher. And I really believe coming out of COVID, God is calling us to go up higher, to go back up onto the higher road. We're called to ascend and not to descend. And so today I've just called this message, Take the Stairs. Take the stairs, okay? We're talking about the final Psalm, that meeting place with God, but there is a process. We've got to take the stairs. Don't be like me in the gym where you walk past and go, no, I don't like it, it's too hard. Take the stairs because it's worth it. So part of getting festival ready is being willing to commit to the stairs. And like I said, this is a picture in Psalm 134. It's a picture of celebration. It's a picture of praise. It's a picture of the end of the journey, meeting your destination. You get to the final part of your destination. But it doesn't mean, sometimes in life, doesn't it? We can sit down on one of the stairs. If you think about these 15 songs, they're like each one of them is a stair. And sometimes we can sit down on one of the stairs. Psalm 120, I'm not going to stay there any longer than I need to. Like I said, it's that place of woe. It's a place of trouble. I want to get off that onto the next step. You move forward onto Psalm 125, and it sounds good. It's a psalm that is safe. It's where you're safe and you're secure. And I think to myself sometimes, it'll be nice to sit here, but there's more. There's more. We've got to commit to taking the stairs. Psalm 129 talks about persevering through pain. To be honest, that's where I might like to backtrack and maybe go back to Psalm 125, that place of safety. But then Psalm 130 talks about waiting and hope. Not a fan of waiting, but there is more. There are more steps. Psalm 132 is believe in God's promise. But then you finally get to your destination. Psalm 134 is all about meeting God, encountering God, coming into his presence. It's your final destination, but you've got to take the stairs to get to that point. So I'm just going to read it again. Psalm 134, praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord who minister by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who is the maker of heaven and earth. And in this psalm, I don't want you to remove yourself from it, because we, when it talks about all you servants of the Lord, we are the servants of the Lord. Back then it was the priests, but today, in today's context, we are the servants of the Lord, and we can praise him in the night watches when it seems like life is at its darkest, the challenging times. We can praise God in these times. And so I just want to talk to you for a few moments about what happens on this final stair, the final stair of the journey. And praise God. You know, you think, oh, I know what that means, but really, do you know what it means? Praising God, it just means to applaud, to honor, to glorify, to exalt, to admire, to boast, to brag, to rave about. And it's an expression of approval of something or someone. And we see so many ways in the Bible of how people praise God. So why praise God? Why praise God? It's so, so, so powerful. And I'm just going to share a few thoughts about praise that just taken from the Bible. So just the first thought is, in praise, God is known. In praise, God is known. So there's a verse in Psalm 76 and verse 1. In the New King James Version, it just says, in Judah, God is known. In Judah, God is known. It's a very, very short verse. In Judah, God is known. Judah means praise. So in praise, God is known. And I don't know if you experienced that this morning, coming in, lifting up the name of Jesus. Somehow, you know God is there. Somehow, you sense who he is, and whatever it is that maybe you're feeling, you just sense it. In praise, God is known. We come to know God when we praise him. And when we praise him, God lets himself be known to us. He is a knowable God. He is a knowable God. He is sovereign, but he is so close that he wants to be known by you. And I just want to look at the life of a well-known Bible character, David. David. Everyone knows David. The story of David and Goliath. This little boy who took the stones and he destroyed Goliath. Because David, in the scripture, David is God's number one dance man. He is God's number one singer, songwriter, praising person. And we're talking about praise today, how God wants to be known. He's going to be known in praise. You know, David's the man who wrote, "This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice. We will be glad in this day." And I love how the Bible describes David. It says that he was a man after God's own heart. How do you get to be a man after God's own heart? It's probably through knowing him. How did he get to know him? In Judah, God is known. In praise, God is known. And I really believe, I've got a conviction when I meet David one day. I reckon he knew how to praise God. You read through the Psalms, he wrote so many of them, and he knew how to praise, which in turn meant that he knew God. He was a man after God's own heart. He tapped into knowing God. And, you know, we know this story. David came to the battlefield one day, and he was the little brother. His father sent him to his brothers to give cheese and bread and take some stuff, some supplies down to where the big boys were fighting this big giant. Except nothing was happening, was it? So David comes, and he comes down, and he sees that this army of God, this army of Israel, is hiding in trenches, and then he sees this giant Goliath, and he thinks, it's the people of God, and they're better at digging trenches, hiding in foxholes, than they are at defeating the Goliath, the giant that's openly defying God. And David had just come back down from being in the fields with the sheep, And there, that's where he learned to praise God. He learned to worship God. And so to him, it was obvious. He was like, well, I know what we need to do because I know my God. In praise, God is known. And, you know, David is the inventor of praise breaks. People talk about praise breaks. We're going to have a praise break. David invented them. It's in the Bible. Psalm 119, verse 64, it just says, I stop. This is David talking. I stop to praise you 7 times a day. All because your ways are perfect. I stop to praise you 7 times a day, not once, not twice, 7 times a day, all because, God, your ways are perfect. 7 times a day, David said, I will praise the Lord. You know, we take tea breaks. We got any tea drinkers? Some tea drinkers. Coffee breaks, coffee drinkers, yes. David took 7 breaks a day. You know, he'd have been doing his kingly duties. He'd been doing what he was doing. And every few hours, he would stop everything. And he would dance, and he would praise, and he would sing a song. He'd lift his hands, he'd lift his voice, and he would praise God. In praise, God is known. I really believe that is a word for someone today. God wants to be known by you. He is closer than you realize. And the number of times there are bumps in the road, that we've all had them, haven't we? Life is not all tickety-boo, unfortunately. And, you know, there was a time when we lived in a flat. It was a small flat with 3 young children. We'd been trying to sell this flat. It was a beautiful flat. I don't know why we couldn't sell it. It was just, there was hiccups. And then the flat flooded. It was a basement flat, and there was this ingress of water that came up from underneath the floorboards. And we were like, oh, okay. Call the insurance company, and they covered it. And then it happened a second time. And I'm like, whose flat floods twice in a short period of time? At which point, the insurance company didn't want to know anything. They said, no, it's not covered. And we were left with this conundrum. We were stuck. We knew we had filled the flat. We needed to move. We needed to take a step. But we didn't know how because we had this massive bill. And at that point, it was close to our annual income, what we needed to pay to be able to get it fixed so that we could put it on the market simply to be able to move to the next step. So we were really stuck. We were really stuck. Really stuck. And I'm not standing here saying that I praise God for the circumstances, because it was horrible, horrible. It's like you can't see a way forward, can't see a way out. But I did have moments where I stood and I praised God for who he is, that he's the one who sits closer than a brother, that he's the one that never leaves me and he never forsakes me. He's the one who's got the plans for me, plans to prosper me, plans to give me and my 3 children hope and a future. So I didn't praise the circumstances, but I did learn to praise God. And you know, in that time, as I chose to praise him, that's where I discovered an amazing scripture, Psalm 65. It just says, even the hardest pathways, they overflow with your abundance. I know now that is the truth because God revealed that part of him in praise. God revealed that in praise. God is known. And I don't know what you're going through today, but I know that I know that I know God is a kind God. And if we will lift our eyes, it's not thanking him or praising him for the circumstances, but praising him for who he is, his character, his loving nature, never to leave you or forsake you. He will give you something. He will reveal a part of him that you would not discover in another season of life when you're up on the mountains. In praise, God is revealed. In praise, God is revealed. Can you say that? In praise, God is revealed. He wants to be made known. And so we're coming back to the story of David. And so we've got David, and David overhears people talking. And he overhears them, and they're saying, if you beat this Goliath giant, you get 3 things. You get a house, and you never have to pay taxes. And he was like, sounds good. Secondly, you get part of the king's kingdom, his wealth. Sounds good. Thirdly, you get to marry one of the king's daughters. And David probably thought, I'm in. I'm paraphrasing. But so he comes. And, you know, Goliath looks at David and he said, who is this boy? So he's young. And he comes and we know what he does. He kills Goliath. He defeats Goliath. So then King Saul comes and he says, bring this boy into the palace. And he introduces him to the daughter called Merab. I don't know. There's a lot of stuff that's not in the Bible, like all the details. How did she feel? How did he feel? What did he think when he saw her? What did she think when she saw him? But in my imagination, I'm like, oh, I wonder, did she like him? Did he like her? But it just says that she didn't marry him. She married someone else because she loved another man called Adriel. So I don't know whether she went, Dad, what are you doing? Like bringing this country boy in. Who do you think? Like, I don't want to marry him. But anyway, she didn't marry him. But then further along in the story, it says that there's a crisis. And then in 1 Samuel 18, verse 20, it says there's another girl called Michelle. And it says, she spoke up, and the Bible said that she loved David. So this is King Saul's another daughter. She loved David. And in verse 28, it says again, she loved David. She loved David. Now, this is a true story, but you've got to see David represents praise. David represents praise. That's what his life represents. He was a man that knew how to praise God. So in other words, Michelle, she's the king's daughter, and she loves David. Praise. She loves David. And we're going to come back to that shortly. I'm going to finish on loving praise. But moving forward in this story of David, we go to chapter 19 of 1 Samuel. And it's just coming up on the screen. It says, King Saul goes a bit crazy. Saul sent men to David's house to watch it and to kill him in the morning. He's gone crazy. But Michelle, now David's wife, she warned him. And she said, if you don't run for your life tonight, David, tomorrow you will be killed. So Michelle let David down through a window, and he fled, and he escaped. So King Saul sent these assassins to watch David, and while he was sleeping, Michelle woke up. She had this intuition, something's not right. And she heard the assassins knocking on the door, and what did she do? She ran, and she opened the window, and she helped David to escape. She helped praise to go out the window. She said, you've got to go out this window or you're going to die. So David represents praise, okay? Just keep that in your mind when I'm talking about David. Michelle ran. She opened the window and she let praise live. She was letting praise live. And that's the second thought. We've got to let praise live. We've got to let praise live. There's too much stuff in the world that would just come. And it's like it puts a hand over our mouth. We've got to let praise live. Let praise live. You know, Michelle said, you've got to learn, this is me paraphrasing again. It's like she says, when you get in dark times, in the nighttime, when there's assassins waiting, and when trouble's knocking at the door, like the assassins were knocking at the door, you've got to learn how to open the window. It's your mouth. Open the window and let praise out. You've got to let praise live to see another day, because that's what you do when it's dark. It's the only thing you can do when it's dark. Psalm 134, remember, it's talking about the night watches coming and praising God in the night watches. And when real trouble comes into your life, you don't just sit there. Hopefully, you don't just sit there and you let praise die, but you open the window. You open the window, you let praise out. And we know the Bible says that though weeping endures for a night, joy comes in the morning. You are going to see another morning, and praise needs to be released into the dark hour. Needs to be released. We need to release praise in the middle of the night watches, in the middle of when things seem dark. So Michelle, David's wife, says twice in the Bible that she loved David. She loved David. She loved praise. And Michelle was the one who enjoyed, and she understood, and she encouraged David to, in the darkest time of their life, to go and praise God. But if we fast forward, it's really interesting. We fast forward 20 years later, the Bible says that a lot of things have changed. So David has now become king. He's now king of Israel, and he's coming back to Jerusalem, and he's bringing what's called the Ark of the Covenant, which is just, it represents the presence of God. He's bringing it back, and he's got singers and musicians at the front, and every six paces they would stop, and they'd offer sacrifice, and the Bible said he would dance, and he would praise with all of his might and all of his strength. 20 years later, he's still there praising God with all of his might and all of his strength. This man was a warrior, but he knew how to praise God. One translation says that every fiber and every muscle in his body was moving when he was praising God. And he was dancing, he was shouting, he was leaping, he was praising. And his wife now, 20 years later, it says she looks out the window. And I don't know, was it the same window that she helped him live? She helped him escape through? Maybe. But it says that she, Michelle, looked at the window, and she looked at her husband, and she despised him. The thing, the person that she'd helped keep alive, she'd helped keep David, helped keep praise alive. She released him out the window. 20 years later, life had knocked her about, and now she looked and she despised him. Problems had done something to her. And you know, a lot can happen in 20 years, can't it? Life goes quickly. I look back 20 years, I'm like, oh, I'm not as young as I once thought I was. I mean, you could start out on fire. You can start out in love with God, in love with praise, in love with church, in love with his word and what God means to you. But a lot of trials can happen, can't they, in 20 years. There can be a lot of setbacks. There can be a lot of pain, a lot of challenges, a lot of illnesses. And there's this day came as God, David was bringing God's presence back to the place where it needed to be. And she looked out that window and she despised him. Maybe she said to herself, I don't need to be in love with praise. I'm talking, David represents praise. Maybe I don't need to be in love with praise like I used to be. I don't need to thank God maybe like I used to. Something happened to her. I don't know what it was. Life had knocks. But Jesus is the same yesterday. And he's the same tomorrow, which means he's the same today. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And we should never lose that our first love, praising God, praising him. And it's like Michelle said to David, you embarrass me. You're acting crazy. You shouldn't be doing this. And I can just imagine, again, I'm paraphrasing, but I can imagine David looking back at her and saying, I want you to understand something. Before your dad knew who I was, my heavenly father saw me and he knew who I was. Before your father brought me into the palace and gave me all this stuff, my heavenly father saw me and he knew who I was. Before that army of Israel saw me bringing the bread and the cheese as a little boy, my heavenly father knew me and he saw me. He knew the plans for he had for me. Before the Samuel, the prophet, ever anointed my head, and my father, my natural earthly father, didn't even bring me to the front when he asked for all the sons. Before that happened, my God was there and he knew me. And I can just imagine him going, so excuse me if I am not going to praise my king, not like he deserves. See, 20 years later, and David is still a praising person. He's still a praising man. And I don't know about you. I've been around in church for a little while and praising God for a while. But I'm just here just to stir a little bit. And I'm talking to myself. If we don't praise God the way that we used to, then maybe, like these songs of ascent, maybe God is bringing us back to a place where we come to a fresh revelation of who he is, a fresh revelation of how high the praises should be for him. Maybe he's bringing us back. But I don't want us to go out like separated and thinking that life has separated us from God. Life happens, but it doesn't change who God is. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he deserves the highest praise. And the Bible just says, it's sad at the end of the story, it just says that Michelle, after she had cursed her husband, it said that she was barren. She was no longer able to produce children. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to stop seeing the fruitfulness of God. I don't want to stop seeing the fruitfulness of God. And there is something, you see, David, he was a praising man. You see, Michelle, she started off, she loved praise. She loved praise, but something happened, and she didn't let praise live. David was allowed to escape, and he let praise live. And you can see the difference. He went on to see the fruitfulness of God in the later part of his life. And I'm just coming back to that phrase where, just thirdly, just talking about Michelle, she loved David. She loved praise. And just the third point is just fall in love with praise again. I really believe God is wanting us to fall in love with praise again. Because in praise, he is known. As you fall in love with praise, you fall in love with God again. Psalm 145, it just says, one generation shall praise him to another, and they shall declare his mighty works. One generation is supposed to praise God in a way that it's not getting smaller, it's not getting diminished, it's not getting quieter, but it's in a way that causes that next generation to declare the greatness, the great works of God. And we've got to be intentional. We've got to be intentional to bring another generation through and not drop the baton. We've got to let our praise arise again. And I'm just going to close with this. So I've talked a lot about 1 Samuel, but if you flip over into chapter 22, it just says it's an amazing story. The Bible says that there's an uprising. There's this fight, and Saul again, crazy Saul, is trying to kill David again. He was a man on a mission. And there were these 86 priests that were helping David. And the Bible says that only one of them returned. The other 85 were killed, but one of them returned. And he came, it says, the Bible says he had an ephod in his hand. And the ephod, that just represents a garment of praise. His priest, that he was carrying it in his hand. There's something wrong with that statement, because the praise garment, the ephod, is meant to be worn. It's not meant to be carried in your hand. It's supposed to be on you. It's supposed to be something that you wear, but it says that he had it in his hand. And so I suppose what I'm trying to say is there's a difference between being in church, praising, and being a praiser. You know, we gather together, and it is really good that we gather together, and something happens as we gather together that is unique. You can't replicate it at home. But when you go home, we're still meant to praise God. We're still meant to lift up the name of Jesus. We're still meant to declare the greatness of his works. And I don't know, I'm just asking the question. Sometimes you become good at praising. You're in church, you're with people, you're leaning on their faith, on their energy, their joy for God. But what happens when you go home? Like this priest, he came. He wasn't wearing what he should have been wearing. He was carrying it in his hand. And I'm just asking him the question, are you carrying praise as you come in? Are you carrying it in your hand? Or do you feel like, no, praise is in my heart. Praise is in my heart. I'm in work and I'm praising God. I'm taking, like David, 7 praise breaks. I don't know. I was in the supermarket. I know I talk a lot about the supermarket. Last week, I was in the crisp aisle and I had my AirPods in, and I was listening to a song by, I think it was Maverick, and it's called Canvas and Clay. I'd never heard it before, and there was part of it where they just broke out into praising God, and I didn't mean to, but my hands came off the shopping trolley like this, and I went, yes, and then turned around as I realized, no, you are in the middle of a supermarket aisle. But there was something in me, praise in my heart. It was all, like, I couldn't help it but respond, yes, that is who God is. You know, it talks in Psalm 134 about lifting hands. That word is yada, Hebrew word, yada. And I don't know, maybe you're here today and you've seen people lifting hands. You think, that is crazy. I was you 20 years ago in a really traditional church, coming in, and you come in, you read from the common book of prayer, you learn when to sit down, when to stand up, and when to like sing hymns, and then you go home and everyone's hands are by their side or in their pockets. But then I met someone and I was intrigued. I was like, there's something different about you. And they invited me to church and I was like, okay, cool. And I went and I saw all these people with hands raised, hands lifted. I didn't know what they were raising their hands to, but I could tell they were encountering God in a way that I'd never experienced, and there was something in me was drawn to that. And so they said, oh, well, why don't you just come? We're doing a summer camp. Come and help with the kids' team. So I did, and again, I was just surrounded by people with hands lifted, which I now realize is yada. It's an expression of surrender, of complete God. I am yours forever. I am yours. It's this picture of a 3-year-old child running towards daddy with his hands up and just saying, daddy, 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 would you carry me? That's what it is, lifting of hands that Psalm 134 is talking about. But I remember coming back into my traditional church. It was an evening service and I was just at the back, and I think we were singing Great Is Your Faithfulness. No word of a lie, it was like my arms just went up in response. Great is your faithfulness. Something in me, praise, I believe it was yada. Something in me was released. Something in me was awakened through being with those people in an environment where they were encountering God, where they were praising God. Because when you praise God, God is known. He makes himself known, and something happened. Something happened as they were praising. I was getting a revelation of God at the time that then caused my arms to be lifted in complete adoration. And I was the only one. It was a really traditional church, and I didn't even care. I was just like, God, you are so good. You are so faithful, so, so faithful. And I suppose I'm just stirring us up as we get festival ready. We've got to learn to take the stairs. Sometimes life does have its pinch points, but in praise, God is known. You're not praising Him for the circumstances, you're praising Him for who He is. We cannot let praise die. We've got to open the window and let praise out into the darkest places, wherever that is. We've got to give it all we can and just come and fall in love with praise again. Allow praise to go from like that priest in his hand to in your heart, where you might be in work and maybe you do have a response. You're like, praise God. That's okay. He deserves to be praised. And so I'd love just to invite you to your feet just as we close. We've talked about taking the stairs. They're good for you. Next time you're at the gym, use the stepper, Stairmaster. But I just want you to close your eyes if you're comfortable. I want you to visualize that you are one of those pilgrims making that journey step by step all the way up to the final destination, the meeting place, the temple in Jerusalem. It just represents meeting God. Holy Spirit's in this room. You know, the Bible says for those who've got a heavy heart to put on a garment of praise. Sometimes it feels hard, but man, it's worth it. In praise, God is known. And what I'd love for us to do, if you're comfortable, is just even just I talked about that yada, just an expression, God, I surrender to you. And if there are any areas maybe where it feels like you have been carrying praise, you've learned to come in praising, but when you go home, it's very different. You know, this is just between you and God, but I want you just to allow something to come out of your mouth. It might be like me. You can't thank God for the circumstances, but you can thank God that He's the one who's closer than a brother, that He's the one who never leaves you, who never forsakes you, that He's the one who knows you, who formed you, who made you because He needs you and He wants you. He wants a relationship with you. So the band are just going to lift the song. And I just want you to allow something to come out of your mouth. You might even just want to start with the name of Jesus, just declaring how great you are, King Jesus. Great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies we see. This morning, mercy and goodness. New mercies are over you. They are chasing you this morning.